Right, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this, the 19th meeting in 2015 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Can I welcome members back after the summer recess? I welcome our witnesses, who I'll introduce in a moment, and anybody joining us in the public gallery. And can I remind everyone, please, to turn off, or at least turn to silent, all mobile phones and other electronic devices so they don't interfere with the sound equipment. We have apologies this morning from Richard Lyle. Item one on the agenda, we are continuing our inquiry into security of supply, and giving evidence this morning are the Competition and Markets Authority. I'd like to welcome, starting on my left, we have Simeon Thornton, who's the Project Director, Energy Market Investigation, Sheila Scobie, who is Head of Devolved Nations and CMA Representative in Scotland, Tony Curzon-Price, Senior Economist, Energy Market Investigation, and Chris Prevett, who is the Legal Director. So welcome to you all, and thank you for joining us. I think before we get into questions, I think, Mr. Thornton, you were wanting to say something just by way of an introductory statement.
Yes. Well, thank you, Convener, for inviting the CMA to give evidence to the committee's inquiry. I would like, by way of introduction, just to give set out briefly the remit of the energy market investigation, how the work conducted to date relates to security of supply, and where we are in the overall process, because we haven't actually completed the investigation yet, and inevitably that will be reflected in the answers that we give to you today. So first, on the remit, the CMA, as you said, is currently undertaking an investigation into the supply and acquisition of energy in Great Britain. So this covers both electricity and gas. It covers both wholesale and retail markets, except that within retail markets, we're only considering retail supply to households and micro-businesses, so we're not considering retail supply to larger businesses. And the geographic coverage is the whole of Great Britain, so the outcomes will clearly be of relevance to Scottish consumers and businesses. It's important to note at the outset that a market investigation is a legal process, which is governed by the Enterprise Act 2002. The decision makers are not the CMA's board or indeed the CMA's chief executive, but a group of independent members. And in this case, the chair is Roger Whitcombe, and he's supported by other members, Martin Cave, Bob Spedding, Leslie Ainsworth, and Malcolm Nicholson. Just a word about the focus of market investigations. The group is required to address a specific statutory question, which is whether any features or combination of features are likely to prevent, restrict, or distort competition. And if such features are found, that constitutes what we call an adverse effect on competition, or an AEC. And where we do find those AECs, then the group must identify potential remedies, either to address the AEC directly or alleviate its effects. And those remedies can take the form of a recommendation to government, or indeed of own action by the CMA through our order-making powers. And those order-making powers are quite stringent and quite wide-ranging. Now, in this case, the reference was made to us on the 26th of June 2014. We have 18 months to complete the inquiry. That's a statutory timetable, and that takes us to Christmas Day this year, of all days. We do have the option of a six-month extension if the members deem that necessary. There are various milestones between the reference and the final report, and we've just reached one in this investigation with the publication of our provisional findings document in July, and that set out the members' views on provisional views on where there might be adverse effects on competition, and indeed a set of potential remedies to address those adverse effects on competition. The purpose of publishing that document is to get parties' views on the evidence that we have looked at and the analysis we've conducted. So, needless to say, they are provisional views. They may well change before the final report. Next key milestone is what we call the provisional decision on remedies, which will be October, and then, as I said, the final report in December. Now, just very briefly on the relationship with our study in security of supply. The focus of the investigation is on competition in general, rather than security of supply in particular. And a lot of the work that we've done and some of the publicity that surrounded it has focused on issues such as consumer engagement in retail markets or the design of the overall regulatory framework that doesn't directly relate to security of supply. That said, we have looked at a number of areas of the policy regime, in particular wholesale market rules and regulations that do have a bearing on security of supply. We've sent you a short note setting out what those are. Doubtless we'll go into the details in the discussion later on. Just to say, the group has not found an AEC in relation to some quite significant areas. So the overall design of the wholesale market, which is what we call self-dispatch, reforms to imbalance prices that Ofgem has introduced, and DEC's introduction of a capacity market, which I know you've been discussing in the inquiry to date. We have provisionally found AECs in relation to the pricing of transmission losses and the mechanism for allocating CFDs. And also, and I did want to highlight this one in particular, the group has provisionally found AECs in relation to the settlement system for both gas and electricity. Again, we can go into the details later on, but I note in your call for evidence that you, I think, rightly identify the importance of demand-side response as a mechanism for improving security of supply in the future, particularly with new intermittent generation coming onto the system. All I would say at this stage is that we don't think there will be substantive demand-side response from domestic customers unless you change the settlement system. So I think that is something worth discussing. Is that okay? Again, we're very happy to be here today. And if the meeting is helpful, then we'd be very happy to come back once we've done our final report and discuss that with you.
Okay. Thank you very much for that introduction. I should say, if you can decide amongst yourselves, you know, who's best placed to answer the questions that are asked, and I'll let you...
Pass it on to
whomever. Yeah. And the only other plea I'd make at the start is you'll appreciate, you know, we are not technical experts. We are mere politicians and laypersons. So some of the terms and language that might be used might be a little above our heads. So if you can bear that in mind and try and simplify it as best you can, that would be very helpful.
If anything's not clear, then let us know. Or if it seems irrelevant, we can move on.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we'll move on to questioning. There's a number of issues you mentioned there that I think we're keen to pick up on around capacity markets, locational pricing, you know, contracts of difference and settlement. So can I just start and pick up the capacity market issue that you touched on? I think you said there were a number of concerns that had been raised with you about the operation of the capacity market and how that might impact on security of supply. Can you say a little bit about what those concerns were and then how you came to the conclusion that the capacity market is broadly competitive? Yes.
Of course. I should say, first of all, that I guess we consider two questions in relation to the capacity market. Firstly, was there a coherent rationale for introducing it? Because it is quite a major change. And secondly, is the design competitive? Just a quick word on the first, if I may. We found there was a coherent argument for the introduction of a capacity market. DEC's stated aim is to introduce it because they were concerned that in an energy-only market, which is what we had before the introduction of the capacity market, potential investors in generation might be sceptical about their ability to recover their costs, partly because prices will need to spike to really high levels. And with the onset of more intermittent renewables, you've got greater volatility in prices. So we think there is a coherent argument. We have observed in the last few years, for example, that generators have not generally earned a rate of return that allows them to cover their cost of capital. So that's some support for the argument that additional support is needed in order to encourage that investment in thermal capacity and other forms of capacity. Now, onto the concerns that were raised with this. I think there were three. One related to the length of contracts available through the capacity market. The second was about the mechanism for recovering costs from the market. And the third was about the penalty mechanisms in place. On the length of agreements, one supplier in particular argued to us that it wasn't fair that if you're a new generating plant, you can get a 15-year contract. But if you're investing in DSR, demand-side response capability, you only get a one-year contract. And I think that we thought in principle, well, that it, you know, we see the argument. However, the reason we didn't find an AEC here was twofold. Firstly, we didn't see evidence of DSR projects that had significant capital outlays currently being frustrated by this system. So it seemed more of a theoretical concern for the future than a practical concern today. And DEC, I think, is alive to it. Secondly, this specific issue is being considered in front of the court, or one of the European courts. And so for those two reasons, we decided not to pursue it further. Second question, again, same supplier actually argued to us that there would be a better way of recovering the cost of the capacity market. Now, these mechanisms, and indeed all of those that we're going to be discussing today, CFDs, are recovered from consumer bills. It was put to us that it would be better if they could be recovered at the peakiest points in the year. There are things called triads, which are basically the three half hours, which are the highest amount of demand. And we considered this question, and we thought that the current approach to recovering the costs of the capacity market seemed appropriate. Basically, they're recovered according to the share of supply in peak times between November and February. We thought that gave the right sort of incentives to providers of capacity, whether it's DSR or conventional capacity, and we didn't see a problem there. Thirdly, just to finish, on the penalty mechanism side, we published in January an updated issue statement, which is a kind of update on our thinking. And we did flag up then a question about the penalties that you pay if you secure payment under the capacity market but don't deliver the capacity in practice. And our concern was, well, these penalties don't look particularly stringent because all you do is you lose the capacity payment. So it seems like a kind of one-way bet. However, parties argued to us that that's not the only penalty available. Under current reforms, and we might touch on these later, Ofgem's current reforms to imbalance prices, we will expect to see much peakier prices in the future. So at times of system stress, which is when you will need this capacity, you'll not just lose the capacity payment if you fail to provide capacity, you'll also be exposed to some quite high prices. Now, under the reforms that are proposed by Ofgem and have recently been adopted, these prices could go to £6,000 a megawatt hour. So that's about 50 times the current retail price. So, you know, I think the members were convinced that given that, there wasn't really a concern at the moment around the kind of stringency of the penalty payment. So overall, to summarise, capacity market, the members were convinced it was a good idea to introduce it. And the various design issues that we looked at, none of them seemed to us to be sufficiently material to represent an AEC.
Okay. Thank you. That was a very helpful summary. Do any members want to follow up on anything on the capacity market? Otherwise, we can move on. Thank you. Okay, I'll bring in Chick Brody, who's got questions on self-dispatch.
Yeah, thank you. Good morning. I wonder if may ask a question about the capacity market in terms of your report that said a number of concerns were raised with us relating to specific aspects of the operation and design of the capacity market. I wonder if you can answer two questions. One is, there is an elephant in the room, I'll use that phrase again, in terms of the national grid. And I'd like to understand how you approach their approach to the competitive market, being wholly monopolistic. And the second thing is, I wonder if you can explain why, in your opinion, if we have a competitive process, that there seems to be an ongoing process of when one of the six larger firms, who are both generators and retailers in some cases, when one puts out a price change, then within weeks, the rest of the generators put out a price change, largely in line with the initial promotion of a price change. So I wonder if you can answer about the national grid and competition and the impact that has on the market, and secondly, why is it that we seem to be, follow the leader when it comes to prices being issued?
Okay, well, to take the national grid question first, in relation to the capacity market, I think that their role is twofold, really. So the process works by which the Secretary of State will say, this is our required security standard. And in this case, it's 3 hours what they call loss of load. In other words, a probability that there will be, in a particular year, 3 hours in which someone somewhere is being disconnected. And then National Grid takes that and says, OK, I think we need to procure X gigawatts of capacity. So that's their function there. And they also hold the auction, and the auction itself was a competitive one and delivered 50 gigawatts of capacity at about £20 a kilowatt, which is rather less than people expected ex ante. So I think National Grid's role, you're right, it is a monopoly, but was to facilitate competition in relation to the capacity market. In relation to National Grid's other functions of balancing the system. In the context of our investigation, we've clearly had to understand them because it's pretty fundamental to understanding how the wholesale market works. But we have, in terms of the object of our investigation, it's been on the competitive elements of the wholesale and retail markets. So the only bits that we've not explicitly taken a view on is the natural monopoly regulation of National Grid and the distribution companies. Well, the reason is that these market investigations are about effective competition, and so we've looked at the competitive elements. There are other mechanisms in place for people to take a view on Ofgem's regulation of natural monopolies, and indeed another part of the CMA is currently looking at a decision that Ofgem made in relation to distribution prices. So if someone disagrees with what Ofgem does in relation to its regulation of natural monopolies, that is appealed to the CMA and we do another investigation there.
Maybe help me with this. In a situation where the national grid, and we've just had one situation certainly in Scotland, which is deeply regrettable, where it has a situation where it, although it doesn't control supply, it measures the demand, the estimate, that they can then, by transmission charging pricing, determine what the supply is going to be. And of course, we know the implications that of reducing supply while demand appears to be increasing is there will be ultimately an increase in pricing. So they have a major impact in the competitive marketplace, and yet they sit there, I know that you say they're controlled by Ofgem, but that was, again, another issue that cropped up in our questioning about the relationship between Ofgem and the National Grid. Why have you not looked at the implications of National Grid's role in the market, because they do have an impact on the marketplace? Why has that not been looked at so that we can determine exactly what impact that's having on the retail price energy?
Well, we have looked at the rules and regulations that underpin the wholesale market. So one of the areas I flagged up was imbalance prices. Do those give the right signals to market participants? And clearly, National Grid has an important role there. We haven't looked at the specific mechanisms that Ofgem uses to regulate National Grid, because, as I've said, that can be, if people have problems with that, then they can refer that specific aspect of Ofgem's decision to the CMA, and we will conduct another exercise, and there is a parallel exercise carrying on. So that's just in terms of our remit. Would you like me to consider the second question about prices? It is one of the questions that we looked at in this investigation, and I think it's probably fair to say that it was one of those areas around which there were concerns in the build-up to Ofgem's investigation of the markets to us. And it's pretty it's true, as you say, that there is a certain amount of what we might call parallelism in pricing behaviour. So one company will announce a change and the other ones will follow suit. Now, why might they do that? Well, I think there are a number of arguments. One is they're generally subject to the same cost pressures. So they all purchase in wholesale markets, and there are some differences in their purchasing strategies, but to the extent to which prices are going up, they generally will all consistently feel those pressures. And the second observation is that, and this is, I think, what the companies themselves have put to us, they don't want to be the first to move if prices are going up, because they lose customers. So if someone else has moved and increased their prices, they're subject to the same pressures, then others will tend to follow. Now, what we didn't see when looking at this question was any evidence of what's called tacit coordination. So we looked in particular, for example, of a situation in which one company would announce its price change, another one would do something else, and then the original company that announced the price change would change its mind. Because that sort of activity could have given the impression of tacit coordination between the players. We didn't find any evidence of that. What we found was they're subject to basically the same cost pressures and a commercial pressure, which is not to increase prices on the standard variable tariff until they absolutely have to.
Forgive me. Cost pressure that they may share is the wholesale price of energy. If you look, and I've done it, the last 6 years, companies' reports of the large six companies, the cost pressures and their structures are different. Mm. So it's unfair to say. I think the wholesale price probably is about 46% of the end price.
Yeah.
So it's not true that they're all subject to the same cost pressures, because their operations are different.
Yes.
Why are we accepting that as a reason?
They're not identical. You're right. But they, and I think we note this in the report, although they might have different strategies, they still are subject to the same underlying drivers. wholesale price is one. As you say, it's about 50%. The other ones are network costs, which are generally passed through. Those have been increasing. Social and environmental obligations, those are increasing. All of these have a strong element of commonality between firms, notwithstanding the fact that, as you say, they have different strategies to try and hedge those risks. So I think that is an important observation when we're trying to consider why they might change prices at broadly the same time.
Anyone else? Any other view? Do you have any views on that?
Well, I'm assuming that Mr. Thornton is speaking for the team. If anybody wants to add anything, you're welcome to.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Liz McDonald.
Thank you very much. Very interested in your provisional findings. Particularly wanted to ask you about the transmission pricing and the implications of that, because clearly you're finding that the absence of locational pricing for transmission losses provisionally you've judged to be anti-competitive. It's a hot topic within this inquiry and generally in debate in Scotland, because it relates so closely to transmission charging. And the argument that's been made before this committee by Ofgem and National Grid in relation to transmission charging is that if that ceased to be locationally linked, then there would be a cost to consumers, although there would clearly be benefits to Scottish generators, there would equally be comparable and very substantial costs to Scottish consumers. Your conclusion is that in spite of the locational charging, the fact there isn't locational pricing means that consumers are losing out substantially. Could you explain the basis of that? And also in particular, I think the figure you used as an annual cost to consumers in Scotland and the north of England of the current system is £40 million, which is a big number. If you reduce that from Scotland and the north of England to Scotland alone, could you identify what the cost was to consumers of the current system?
Certainly. So you're right. The current transmission charging arrangements do have some locational elements. And the bit that you were talking about is called transmission network use of system charges, which is basically the cost for using the transmission network. What we've identified is that there is no method for locationally charging for losses. Now, losses are the heat that's dissipated from the wires when you transport electricity over long distances. It's about just under 2% of total generation across Great Britain. And the important point to note is that the losses you incur differ according to your geographical location. So if you're a consumer located near to generation, then when you consume, you generally incur fewer losses. If you are a generator located near to lots of generators, you generally incur higher losses. So those losses do differ, sorry, the costs do differ by geographical location, but the charging regime doesn't. So what happens currently is that consumers and generators all pay the costs of losses, irrespective of where they are in the country. And the members have provisionally found that this, as you say, creates a distortion. It's a distortion in competition between generators because it arguably leads to potentially inefficient dispatch. It has that kind of short-run effect. In the long run, it might also have some impact on where both generators are located and also companies that consume large amounts of electricity are located. Two figures that might be of interest to you, and these figures come from work that was done in 2011, and we'll be looking to update that, so these are all provisional figures. In terms of an overall benefit to the system of introducing locational charging for transmission losses, we estimated it was about 160 to 275 million MPV. As I said, those are figures in the public domain, but we were looking to update those with further evidence in our final report. And the transfer you mentioned, because consumers in Scotland generally located closer to generation than those in England, there would, according to the same analysis, be a transfer of about 40 million. We haven't at the moment broken that down between North of England and Scotland. We are doing further work and our own analytical work to try and understand that. But that is the basic position, I think, as you've set it out. It's set out correctly. This is dealing with losses, which currently are socialised across the country rather than locationally charged.
That's helpful. When transmission charges have been, when TNUS has been discussed in this committee, the fact of transmission losses has been one of the explanations offered for that. But in fact, what you're saying is that those charges don't at all reflect the actual losses in transmission. So if there's a benefit to consumers in Scotland and the north of England of £40 million from a change of the kind you've suggested, clearly one person's benefit is another person's loss. Would that principally come from consumers in the south of Britain or principally come from generators?
So I think probably it makes sense to think about transfers from consumers to consumers and generators to generators. So on the consumer side, it's consumers in the south of England to north and Scotland. On the generator side, there is a broadly equivalent, but for some reason slightly different, which I can't, roughly about £40 million transfer from generators in the north and Scotland to generators in the south. So those transfers are broadly equivalent.
What that would mean then if the conclusion of your report is that this is anti-competitive and it needs to be adjusted, then it will potentially be good news for consumers here. But the generators, the power companies who currently complain about the impact on their profitability of transmission charges will find that they're facing a greater a burden, if you like, of transmission charging, because it will then reflect more accurately the actual cost of transmission from Scotland to markets elsewhere. That's an accurate summary. That's very helpful. Given the recommendation you've made and potentially very significant implications of that, what would be the most likely route in your view, assuming that your provisional finding is upheld and that government decides to act upon it? What would follow from that?
I'm quite cautious about speculating simply because history suggests that decisions can and views can change from provisional findings to the final report. What I would say is that in the remedies notice, we've set out a number of options if indeed this AEC finding is upheld, one of which would be to introduce locational charging for losses ourselves through an order, and the other would be a recommendation. In this case, it would be to Ofgem, who presumably would raise a modification in the code modifications process. So those are the two routes. Of course, there is still a route, an option, which is that on the basis of the additional evidence and analysis that we do and that parties present to us, members think it's not worth it. So that both of those are still in play.
That's useful to understand. You'll be aware that Ofgem themselves have made a modification to the transmission charging regime as it impacts on renewable generators in Scotland to reduce the burden on renewable generators in Scotland by modifying the way in which the transmission charges have been calculated. Is there a danger of government policy or official policy in response to these things moving in two different directions at the same time?
I'm trying to remember, is that connect and manage? Is that the...
Yeah, it's project transmit.
So my understanding, but it's not been a particular focus of the investigation, is that connect and manage was to try to facilitate rapid access to the transmission system and then deal with the charging afterwards, as opposed to a queuing system. Now, I don't think there is any inconsistency between that facilitating access approach and an approach that would charge losses in a cost-reflective way. It is the case, you know, with lots of elements of government policies that they might move in different ways, but I don't think that would be an argument for having one policy try to deal with all different objectives.
Thank you very much.
If I could just add to what Simeon's just said and bring it back to something you mentioned at the outset, which is one of the key next steps in the investigation is the preparation of the provisional decision on remedies. And in the build-up to issuing that document, the group will be very much considering what is the appropriate remedy to any provisional AEC finding were it to be cemented. And in doing so, they'll consider what sort of remedy is effective and what sort of remedy is proportionate. And so at the moment, no decisions have been taken on that. And one aspect of their considering what is the effective and proportionate remedy is exactly as you articulated, the interplay of potential future regulations and other government measures.
Thank you very much.
Okay. I think Gordon McDonald wants to follow some of this up. Yeah.
Just a very quick question. On the report that you produced, Energy Market Investigation, Locational Pricing in the Electricity Market in Great Britain, dated 23rd of February 2015, you said that locational pricing would have distributional consequences for both generators and consumers. Consumers in areas where generation is plentiful but transmission constraint, for example Scotland, would enjoy lower prices, Academic research suggests that an average domestic consumers would benefit from an estimated £64 off annual energy bills. This means that in broad terms that consumers in the north would be net beneficiaries from increased locational pricing, and that the geographical distribution of fuel poverty means that reducing bills in the north would tend to help to alleviate fuel poverty. So given those circumstances and the fact that you identified it as an AEC, how do we go about getting an element of locational pricing introduced, and do you intend to do any more investigation on the subject?
I'll hand over to Tony for some of the details in a minute, but in terms of how we might do it, again, provisional finding, if members do decide this is an AEC that should be remedied, there are two routes. One is to recommend to Ofgem that they should encourage a code modification to be raised. Now, codes are rather a kind of obscure area of the overall regulatory framework, but they're the detailed rules that set out who does what. And the traditional way in which these sorts of rules will be changed is through a code modification process. Now, there have been some attempts to do this over the last 20 years, and they have tended to take many years and end with no clear outcome. In some cases, it's been judicially reviewed for timing purposes, etc. So that is one route. The other route is that the CMA could use its order-making powers to change license conditions to require companies to raise such a modification in the code modification process. So those are the two main routes. And I think, you know, in taking a view on which is the most appropriate, members will want to see and take a view on which is most likely to remedy the problem we've identified. Do you want to add something?
Just to add, the £64 figure you referred to was largely made up of a benefit from resolving pricing of transmission constraints rather than losses. The difference is, if you want to think about it, so losses is, as Simeon said, if you're transporting milk and you spill milk, that's the loss. The transmission constraint is if you're transporting milk but actually the road can't take any more. Now, so most of that £64 was about the transmission constraint and not the losses. The reason that we didn't pursue the transmission constraint issue is that there's a European process that's in place to decide whether or not geographical areas should be considered as one market or several markets. That regulation has just come into force, and there's a process by which at least every 3 years Ofgem has to report to the European level as to whether markets should be unified or split, whether there should be a single price or several prices in different geographies. And our view was that given that substantial piece of work has to be done through the European process that's just been put in place, that was the right place to consider that question.
I think it's also fair to say that, as Tony said, we did flag up the question of transmission constraints as well as losses at an earlier stage. We were persuaded by the party's arguments that implementing a system of transmission locational pricing for transmission constraints would be more complicated than that for losses. And so that was another consideration in thinking that we should hold off on the constraints side. On the losses side, there's a fairly simple mechanism for implementing it, so that's not a compelling argument.
Thank you. Okay. I know Lewis wants to come back, and just one follow-up question for Mr. McDonald's question. If you were to make a conclusion or recommendation that this is an AEC, what would be a realistic timescale to expect a change to come through in terms of policy?
I could say something there. I mean, if the AEC is firmed up, then if the CMA then chooses to use its order-making powers, there is a statutory time frame which applies to that process, and that will be a legal document which the CMA would produce, and the time frame for that is 6 months, subject to a one-off extension of up to a further 4 months. If the CMA makes a recommendation, then at that point, this is the alternative to the order, then through a recommendation, the CMA effectively hands over implementation to whichever body it's made a recommendation to, be that government, be that Ofgem. And at that point, the CMA ceases to have control over the process, and therefore the implementation time period is very much in the hands of others. And that time frame and that lack of control is a factor that the CMA takes into account when deciding upon how effective a particular remedy route will be.
Okay, and how then would the CMA decide whether it was an order or whether it was an issue that you passed on to a third party?
It very much depends on a case-by-case basis in the circumstances of the evidence before the CMA and the group, depending on whether the body being recommended to would take it forward, how they would take it forward, and when, in the group's view, that would be likely. Quite often, the CMA works quite closely with a body if there will be a recommendation to understand that body's perspectives on it. For example, if you look at the government, there's a commitment to implement or to respond formally to a recommendation made by the CMA within 90 days. Now, that's not obviously a cast-iron guarantee they will implement, but at least it is a response. Similarly, but by working with Ofgem, then the group can get a view on the likelihood of Ofgem taking forward a particular recommendation.
Okay, thank you. Okay.
I just wanted to come back briefly because I think what you've said and in answer to Gordon MacDonald as well emphasised that there may be choices here for government as between assisting generators or assisting consumers, and clearly this committee will want to have that in mind in reaching recommendations. When you talked about doing more work to identify the benefit to consumers in Scotland of an increased locational element, I wonder how early you're likely to have conclusions from that. How quickly you might be able to quantify the cost of these losses not being reflected in charging to Scottish consumers, and whether this committee could have access to that information.
I guess the next staging point is the provisional decision on remedies, and we would certainly look to flag up updated analysis at that stage, and that's currently scheduled for October. So that will not be the final answer, but that will be an update of the analysis.
Okay, and in terms of the analysis between Scotland and the north of England, would you be able to write to the committee about that in the meantime with your best estimate of what that actually looks like?
I guess one consideration is we're subject to quite stringent rules in terms of due process, and that's consistent with our quite stringent powers that we have. And so an implication of that is that when we present new information, we do so across the board in public and to all parties. So I think it would be problematic for us to update analysis on an individual basis. Chris, I don't know if you want to.
I entirely agree with what Simeon said, and I would add to that, as part of this legal process, we obviously receive an awful lot of information which is confidential from the parties which are active in this market, and as part of our investigatory powers, we have a duty to protect the confidential information that companies submit to us. There are very limited circumstances in which we can disclose them, and one of the gateways through which we do is the publication of our findings on an interim basis, which might be provisional findings or the provisional decision on remedies, or ultimately in the final report. And that is, I think, the committee's first port of call, I would suggest, of that information.
Certainly draw to your attention, happy to write to you on publication to highlight the updated analysis.
That's helpful. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, I think we want to move on and look at a slightly different topic, which is contracts for difference, and I'll bring in Dennis Robinson.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Within your report, you've sort of noted that there's perhaps a lack of evidence as to DEC's approach to the separation of the technologies with regard to the funding with the CFDs. And in terms of, you know, if we're looking at the best outcome for consumers, what impact do you think that the decision for the separation of the technologies with the CFD is going to have on the consumers and the security of supply?
I think there are two aspects of CFDs that we looked at, allocation of CFDs. One of them was the decision not to allocate a certain proportion of CFDs on a competitive basis. And the other was the definition of different budgets and pots, as you identify. Now, in the first case, we think there's fairly compelling evidence that the DEC's decision not to allocate a 5 offshore wind projects on a competitive basis earlier in 2014 led to increased prices for consumers, and it was of the order of maybe £300 million a year, so quite material amounts of money, about 1% of electricity revenues. On the second question, and the one that you specifically highlight, it's difficult to conclude what the specific impact will be of dividing technologies into different pots. And the reason I say that is that the bidders responded effectively to DEC's decision. So DEC created two pots and put different budgets in each. And unsurprisingly, in the budget in the pot in which there was a smaller budget, there were fewer bidders. So it's difficult for us to replicate exactly what would have happened in the case of having just one budget and one single pot. But in principle, one can think that dividing those different technologies into different pots is likely to increase the price for consumers overall. In terms of the impact on security of supply, I mean, potentially one could use that division of technologies into pots to differentiate technologies according to their security of supply characteristics. So, for example, you could put intermittent technologies in one and more stable firm technologies in another. That has not been our understanding of what DEC has done to date, but it could be a particular mechanism that they pursue. Tony, I don't know if you want to add anything or...
No, I think that captures it.
but in reference of, do you not think that the methodology used by DEC is actually disadvantaging investment in certain areas? And if we look at, for instance, the onshore and inshore wind technologies, which, you know, Scotland, in terms of, we say, in terms of our resource and ability to create the wind energy that would obviously ensure security of supply, I don't think we're being there's a disadvantage to the way that this is being decided. And, you know, I'm trying still to understand the methodology that DEC have used here, and I'm not quite sure I've grasped that yet.
Not quite sure of...
I've grasped the methodology that DEC have actually
possibly
taken
you
forward.
And me both, actually. we have actually said in the report that it wasn't clear to us the basis on which the division of technologies to pots was made. So I've given you a kind of plausible argument for how you might do it. I don't think that is how DEC did it. And indeed, our recommendation generally in this area is that there should be greater transparency about the decision-making process, so the costs and benefits. Because as you say, some of these technologies are much cheaper than others. There may be legitimate reasons for wanting to foster some technologies if we think deployment in GB can reduce the costs. But I'm sorry?
Are those political?
Technocratic or technology-based reasons or cost-based reasons for wanting to deploy certain technologies. There may be. But that needs to be amenable to scrutiny and analysis. And our main concern really is that those decisions that have been taken to date haven't been. And so the more that we can put that evidence and information into the public domain, the better the decision-making process.
So I put it to you in terms of what's being brought forward. I'm not sure you're able to answer this, but if I put forward to you what's being brought forward with regarding to CFD, we have created DEC's created a situation where... many companies are going to feel disadvantaged to invest in technologies which could and probably would ensure security supply for the future, but they're being disadvantaged by the what has been brought forward by DEC at the moment.
And do you have specific technologies in mind here or technologies?
I'm thinking about probably wind and solar.
Yes, so that would be what's called POT 1 technologies. Those are the cheaper technologies, and I think we did raise a question.
We do acknowledge they are cheaper, because some people say that actually they're more expensive, but we agree that they are cheaper?
Well, certainly on a required subsidy basis and technology basis, yes, they are cheaper. Now, there's one complicating factor, which is intermittency. But if you compare onshore wind and offshore wind, they're equally intermittent, arguably, but one is much more expensive than the other. Now, again, there might be legitimate reasons in terms of bringing down the costs of offshore wind. Clearly, Great Britain and Scotland in particular has a lot of expertise in that area. But let's set out the analysis and evidence, and to date we haven't seen that.
Are you going to continue to monitor where we are with this and trying to understand the approach from DEC, and if it's not in the interest of consumer at the end of the day and security of supply for the future, can you challenge?
I'll say something about that and maybe then hand over to Chris. The remedy here, I think, that we have floated in our remedies notice is one about greater scrutiny and transparency of costs and benefits. So, in other words, greater rigour to the decision-making process rather than a recommendation that X or Y should not be done. So that's where the members are at the moment, rather than something more stringent. Chris, I don't know if you want to...
Yeah, I absolutely agree. What the group hasn't done is looked at the relative merits of which technology should be in which pot and which is more cost-effective than others. The group is concerned about, or in the provisional findings, the group articulates its concerns about the rigour, as Simeon has said, to the decision-making process about how those technologies are allocated and how the budget is then allocated between them. And with that rigour in place, that would then give the appropriate level of public scrutiny to assess how those decisions are taken, which is absent at the moment.
And do you envisage that you would be able to take that forward then? It's absent at the moment. Do you envisage that, given that you've perhaps got concerns as to where we are, that you could, or in fact would, be looking at this in the future?
It's clearly an issue that is a live one in terms of the investigation. We've got a potential remedy out there. And in the event that that is a remedy that we stick with in terms of a recommendation, then government has undertaken to respond on that within 3 years.
Share that potential remedy with us?
Yes, indeed. In fact, we can write to you. I mean, the remedy, the detail of the remedy, we can certainly set out. It's in our remedies notice, and we'll write to you with the ins and outs of that. But that's a potential one at the moment.
Yeah, thank you.
I think Patrick Harvey wanted to follow this up.
Yeah, thank you. Mr. Thornton's later answers actually got to some of the issues I was going to follow up on. It just seemed to me that earlier on, in discussing the way in which different generating technologies are treated, it seemed almost as though we were still stuck in Mr. Curzon-Price's analogy of transporting milk, as though it's all the same stuff. It's not all the same stuff. It doesn't come with the same social and environmental consequences. And if we're in the middle of an agenda of re-engineering our energy system in order to meet current and future priorities...
Sorry, excuse me.
I had a train of thought there. It seems to me that the obsession with asking only whether markets are operating efficiently seems almost myopic. Surely we need to have a broader sense of what is trying to be achieved here, and you talked about fostering new technologies. That is a reasonable argument for justifying temporary inefficiencies, isn't it?
I mean, I think that, to be honest, we would use probably efficiency in a broader term than it's sometimes used, to look at wanting to minimise overall long-term costs. And those long-term costs might be costs of more expensive technologies that can be brought down by deployment today. It might be about innovation externalities. It certainly will include the cost of climate change. So ideally what one would do in a sort of social cost-benefit analysis of the sort that we're recommending is set out transparently what is the evidence about supporting this technology rather than that technology. What are the additional costs today in terms of consumer bills? How might those be brought down in the future? And yes, there's going to be elements of judgment, clearly. In a previous world, I was... I was DEC's chief economist before coming to the CMA, and that is the sort of work that we do, try to make it transparent and try to set out the costs and benefits clearly. What I think we should avoid is a situation in which a kind of qualitative argument about this might be a good technology for the future means there's no constraint on the price that we pay today.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. Can I just remind members they should not be using their mobile phones in committee? Thank you.
Back to us.
Yes, well, indeed. Damn that technology. Okay, we'll move on. Thank you. I think Lewis MacDonald wanted to come in with a question on settlement issues.
Yes, I did. We've heard a lot again over the summer about the rollout of smart meters, and clearly, if that goes according to the optimum potential, then it may well address this question in any case. But I think reading your provisional findings, you're not satisfied that there is the necessary follow-up to the rollout in order to ensure that costs are more accurately reflected. Can you tell us, first of all, what the impact is on consumers and indeed on the efficiency of the system in general of its current shortcomings and whether smart meters can address that in full?
Absolutely. If you just let me give a couple of words of kind of introduction to the topic, because it's not one that gets an awful lot of airtime. So obviously when you and I consume electricity, we do so in real time, and there's always a certain uncertainty about when we're going to consume and how much. And that means that despite energy suppliers' best efforts, there's always going to be some disparity between the amount of electricity that they've procured in advance through contracts and the amount of electricity that their customers actually consume. And settlement is a system by which disparities between the amount they've procured and the amount their customers consume are identified, and all the financial participants are made whole in the system. So again, it sounds kind of quite an arid area, but it's quite important. And the reason is, I know you'll have heard in the course of this inquiry, that the costs of electricity differ quite substantially over the course of a day. So in peak times, when we're all consuming electricity, you have to deploy these plants, they've got high variable costs. Off-peak times, the cost might well be negative with some of the subsidy regimes we have. So high volatility of costs, and that's going to increase in the future with more wind power. So you can immediately see that there would be a benefit if we could encourage some customers to shift their consumption from peak times to off-peak times as a dividend there for all customers. Now, the problem is that suppliers under the current settlement system have no incentive to effect this sort of change. The reason is that they are remunerated or charged, as the case may be, as if their customers consumed according to a predetermined profile. And that profile has been put in place because in the world of conventional meters, there was no way of telling who consumed what when. You just had to guess, really. Our concern is that even with the introduction of smart meters, and in principle we're all going to have smart meters by 2020, the system of settlement's not going to change. So suppliers are still going to be remunerated as if their customers consumed according to a profile. And the evidence that is there that would allow for actually those incentives to be brought to bear time of use tariffs is not going to be used. So it is, as I said, it's kind of not an issue that gets an awful lot of airtime, but it is a fundamental one. In terms of quantifying, I think we haven't got there yet, and we're going to look at the experience of other countries which have introduced smart meters and whether they've changed the settlement systems, try and get a sense of the prize there. But what I would say is that this issue is going to get bigger and bigger, because the more you have wind power, the more you have certain times of the day where the price is effectively negative, and other times of the day, particularly with the reforms to imbalance prices that Ofgem was introduced, where prices could be very high, up to £6,000 a megawatt hour. It's a very, very big prize there. And unless we change the settlement system, we can't exploit it.
And changing the settlement system, if I understand you rightly, would mean that that prize wouldn't go to the companies which were smartest at working the market. It would potentially go to the consumer and reflect the actual use of
electricity. So there would be a reduction in overall costs. If you can imagine that the consumption profile does something like this and you can make it flat, overall costs are going to fall for consumers.
And I think your conclusion is that what's needed is a firm plan to deliver this, presumably alongside the rollout of smart meters. So is it a firm plan that is delivered over the next 5 years rather than something that has to be in place straight away?
I think we have been clear in the remedies notice in saying we wouldn't expect it to happen overnight. But the experience of these code modification processes is that they can take a long time. So if we don't start planning now, it might be a very long time until we introduce it.
Okay, Joan McAlpin's got a follow-up question.
So a quick supplementary on that. Can I ask, have you looked at how contracts for difference affects energy storage technologies? We've talked about in this inquiry how energy storage might mitigate intermittency of other technologies, for example, and I wondered whether you looked at whether CFD was working for that particular technology.
Well, let me start with the kind of micro end of energy storage, because, you know, in the future, I guess, we hope there will be more electric cars, storage systems there. This settlement change that I'm talking about will be necessary in order to exploit those sorts of micro technologies. For CFDs that are obviously orientated towards larger scale technologies, To my knowledge, there is no CFD for storage technologies. Is that right?
That's correct, yeah. But my understanding is that if you have a wind, for example, a wind turbine with a battery, it's a much more attractive investment if that battery cost is low than a wind turbine on its own, because that wind turbine can even out peaks in its output. So it should be able, that wind turbine plus storage should be able to benefit from the CFD regime more than a wind turbine on its own.
And just could I quickly ask, what about, you know, like forms of energy storage that aren't directly linked to the wind turbine, but, you know, as part of the whole system, you know, for example, pump storage, how does that work? Because I know that some pump storage schemes in Scotland haven't gone ahead because of concerns about this.
So the short answer is we've not specifically addressed that in the investigation. To my knowledge, those sorts of plant would be remunerated under contracts that National Grid would let for ancillary services under the current regime rather than CFDs, but we've not explicitly taken a view on that.
All right, thank you. Yeah. Patrick.
Yeah, thank you. I just wanted to pick up on some of the points that Lewis McDonald was talking about around smart meters and how that connects to customers' behaviour in the retail market. In the summary of your provisional findings, this comes under a heading where phrases like weak customer response and inactive consumer base are used. And I'm just wondering, you know, alongside the comments you make about smart meters and the comments you make about incentives for people to switch and to engage more actively in the market, I just wonder if there's a false assumption in here, an unsafe assumption, that's what people want. This sense that a kind of abstract sense that markets must operate efficiently and people must all be players in the market, as though we're, you know, deciding which shop to buy a box of breakfast cereal from. Don't we need to start with an assumption or an understanding of how people want to engage with this? And I wonder if you've considered that most people just want to not think about it very much, even if one day a smart meter will do some clever thinking about how their household is going to consume electricity. Most people don't necessarily want to be thinking of themselves as active consumers in a market. They just want to press a switch and not pay too much of a bill.
Yeah, it's a fair challenge, and I certainly don't think activity is an end in itself. We did do a survey of 7,000 customers across Great Britain. And one of the findings, perhaps unsurprisingly, was that the number one attribute that customers care about is the price they pay for their gas and electricity. And we also observed that there were substantial savings that could have been made by customers from switching that weren't being exploited. So across all of the dual fuel customers of the six large energy firms, that was equivalent to about 14% or £160 a year. For some customer categories, so those who are on standard variable tariff and paying by standard credit, the average was 22% of their bill a year, so that's £250-odd. These are very substantial amounts of money. That we also observed that, from our survey, the people who engage least are generally those on low incomes, low levels of education, those with disabilities. So I think that was quite a significant finding, because had we found that it was generally those who were better off who were engaging less, you might have concluded it just doesn't really matter to them. But I don't think that's a very compelling argument, given that evidence that the people who are engaging less and leaving most money on the table are those who are vulnerable against a number of characteristics. Another thing that struck us was that over a third of customers in the survey said they had never considered switching. Slightly higher than that number said they did not know you could switch all of supplier, tariff and payment method. So in answer to your question, I don't think we would expect to see lots of switching as a sign of activity, but we would expect to see people engaged, aware, understanding their responsibilities. And where there are material savings to be made for certain demographic groups for whom it's very important, that those would be exploited.
There are loads of areas of life where we might imagine lots more rational decisions resulting in people saving money on wasting less food or buying less processed food, on making fewer discretionary journeys that they don't necessarily need to make, or living closer to where they work. We can't just assume that that's going to happen, or even that actually people would choose to behave in strictly rational ways as though we're all participants in some theoretical kind of game theory exercise. We're not. We're human beings, and we make kind of woolly, irrational decisions, and quite a lot of the time we're comfortable with that. And I'm just wondering still whether there's an assumption built in here that rational behaviour is going to emerge when it may in fact not.
Certainly, you know, what we have observed is probably the opposite of that. In other words, what we have observed is people not exploiting opportunities to save money, even though the actual costs of switching are not very great. I think we're quite mindful of the points that you raise, and one of the sets of remedies that we flagged up as ones to explore are, you know, behavioural remedies. How can you frame certain decisions in a way that will facilitate people's decision-making rather than just assuming they can do a calculus themselves? It's also worth noting that we have identified specific barriers to engagement for certain categories of customer. So those customers who are on prepayment meters, for example, and there is a higher proportion of those in Scotland compared to England, have those sorts of demographic characteristics that I set out, but also haven't been able to benefit from competition because they generally have fewer tariffs available to them and they pay more than customers who are not on prepayment meters. So that's a category of customer who, you know, their rationality notwithstanding, they can't engage because they don't have those choices. So there are certain, and customers in rental accommodation also seem to engage less. So there are certain segments where there appear to be real constraints. For the others where, as you say, there might be a question about whether they are rationally exploiting the opportunities on offer, we have flagged up there might be ways of trying to nudge them into behaviour or trying to encourage them to engage or facilitate that decision-making process, and that's something that we're looking at.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Yeah.
Just to follow up on that and maybe take it the next stage further, you have the information, you've done the analysis, you've talked about remedies, and you've illustrated that perhaps maybe more education in some respects or whatever to assist consumers. But you've also identified, as Mr. Harvey did, a number of consumers who it's not because they are reluctant to, it's because they may not have the ability to engage to try to save money in some respects. How do you intend to try and address that aspect to try and ensure that the consumers, who are probably some of the most vulnerable within our communities, actually get a fairer deal?
Well, the strategy that is set out in the remedies notice is three part. So the first is about ensuring the conditions for effective competition. And under that bracket, I would put the settlement change that I mentioned earlier. I think that'll encourage suppliers to offer products that engage customers. The second is about finding the means to improve customer engagement, and that could encompass quite a wide variety of interventions. Maybe how some of the questions are framed, maybe specific proposals for overcoming barriers for customers on prepayment meters. And the third area that we flagged up was transitional safeguards for certain types of customers who, notwithstanding our efforts, are unable to engage or take advantage from what's on offer. So we flagged up one possibility, which is to effectively put a ceiling on certain types of price for a certain period of time until such engagement comes forth. Clearly, as we set out in the remedies notice, that is not without its risks. And we've raised a number of questions as to what the scope of such a safeguard tariff should be, and indeed what some of the practical questions behind the design of it would be. But I think we've got those three prongs, as it were, of a strategy, where the third one we would look at if we felt the first two weren't working.
If we look at, you know, the second aspect, and I'm looking at the engagement, have you set a time frame for this, and have you estimated a cost? Because again, I'm still trying to understand how you get the information out to consumer who themselves are, maybe find it difficult to engage. And it's not because of a reluctance to try and save money, because they probably do. They would always wish to save money if they could. How proactive can you be? Or how proactive can you set out a marker for not yourselves, but for others to be?
Well, just one sort of personal observation here. When you look at the complaints that energy customers make about suppliers, the vast majority of them relate to their bill. And it's largely because you get a bill that says, we thought you were going to pay this last month, you actually paid this, this is your outstanding balance, this is the amount you pay by direct debit. It's a very complicated thing to understand. And that will be addressed with smart meters. And the confusion around the bill and what you're paying, the visibility about your consumption and what you're paying for it, I think will be improved. So I think there is a real possibility that smart meters will be part of that transformation. As for what other markers we can put out, timescales, I think any remedy that we would look to introduce would have a time scale associated with it. Chris, I don't know if you want to, or Tony, say something about that.
I suppose what I would add is linked to my answer earlier, which is we're at a stage in the investigation where the provisional decision on remedies hasn't yet come out. So a lot of the thinking in this space is currently ongoing. So there really is quite a limit to what we can say. Obviously, time frame of implementation is a key factor. So is the estimated cost, as is the benefit of any given remedy and its effectiveness and proportionality in addressing any ultimate AEC the group finds. So it's very much a watch this space at this moment, I'm afraid.
Tackling fuel poverty is obviously a priority on that.
Yes. I mean, the group's priority is obviously answering the statutory question, and one aspect of that is considering aspects of fuel poverty, but I wouldn't say it's the key priority. It is just one of the considerations taken into account when answering the statutory question here.
I mean, I said it priority because it's still impacting in the most vulnerable groups within our communities.
Yeah.
And for me, obviously, I would have seen that as a greater priority.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Thanks. Okay. Elizabeth. Very much. Just when we're talking about engagement of with consumers and consumer behaviour, clearly in a competitive sense, there are parts of Scotland, parts of GB indeed, which are competitively at a disadvantage for consumers because they're not on the gas grid. And there are, I think it's fair to say, some practices by electricity suppliers in some rural parts of Scotland which are anti-competitive and make life very difficult for consumers. Are those practices something that would be subject to the current investigation? And would you welcome evidence on those?
Well, to take the second first, we certainly would welcome evidence on any matter that committee thinks should be brought to our attention. In relation, I wonder whether you're talking about dynamic tele-switched meters, is that right, the DTS meters? And we have heard of the sorts of constraints that those impose on customers. And I'd probably put them in a bracket similar to prepayment customers. To our knowledge, DTS meters have a relatively restricted range of suppliers from which to choose. And we've also heard, I think, anecdotally, that some of the customers have difficulty in actually using the technology effectively. And, whereas it was a good idea, it may have passed its sell-by date. I think in terms of a potential remedy, probably I would look to smart meters again, because when you alleviate that constraint of the meter, in principle, those customers should have free range of the suppliers they can choose from. So I think really that would be what we would suggest in terms of a likely remedy at this stage.
Very much.
Gordon McDonald.
I wanted to take this opportunity to ask you about interconnectors and what impact that has on the UK energy market. And in particular, what effect, currently we're in a situation where UK electricity needs are about 8 to 10% is met by the interconnectors to France and Netherlands, and there are proposals to put in place other interconnectors from Norway and from Belgium. When these come on stream, what effect will that have on the energy market and the impact on existing UK generators And secondly, is there any advantage that European generators using the interconnectors have over UK-based generators?
I may be forced to hand over to Tony in a minute, but the short answer is it hasn't been a great focus of our investigation. We did look at some aspects of interconnectors. So, for example, to what extent interconnectors can take part in the capacity market. My understanding is that they will be able to in the future, although there still is a question as to how they will be derated. So the question is, you've got capacity through an interconnector, but the times in which in GB that capacity is likely to be required, winter's day, cold winter's day, it'll probably also be required on the other side of the interconnector. So there's a question about how firm that capacity is, and I think DEC is currently doing some work about how to derate the interconnection capacity to include it in the capacity market. So we didn't see a particular impediment to interconnection there. In terms of whether companies are advantaged through using an interconnector as opposed to current generators, did you want to say something about that, Tony?
Well,
again, I should say it hasn't been a big focus.
It hasn't. No. We are looking further at this. I think the first thing is that more interconnection is basically a good thing for security of supply, and there's a big European push for more interconnection. Now, there's a mechanism by which the transmission costs and the loss, including the losses of interconnection, are taken account of and fed back to the generators wherever that originating generator is. And that's a Europe-wide regulation which is implemented in a specific way. That's something that whose impact we're currently still investigating.
Given the size of dependence on interconnectors at present, as much as 10%, I mean, why wasn't it part of your feature of the energy market?
It certainly was in terms of broadly looking at the competitiveness of the wholesale market, because they are an important part of that. And as I say, there is a mechanism which is certainly in principle meant to be cost reflective, and we're continuing to look at that.
I think also in terms of, I'd say generally, is that in terms of the scope and the focus, that's determined by the members, and partly in response to the representations that are made to us. And in relation to interconnection, certainly in the period up to the provisional findings, we did not receive representations that there was a problem with the regulatory regime for interconnection. So it wasn't a point that people made to us. Now, I think we have seen in some of the evidence that you've had over the last few months that a specific point about interconnection has been made, and that's why we're looking at it at the moment.
Yes, I wonder if I may, through Mr. Thornton, ask Sheila Scobie, who is Head of Devolved Nations and CMA representative in Scotland. We've heard discussed the issue many times about the cost to Scottish consumers of transmission costs and the subsidy of to those consumers in the southeast of England. Can you tell us what discussions you've had recently with Ofgem and what their approach has been to, I assume, a fairly robust presentation to them on behalf of the consumers in Scotland, because clearly the markets are somewhat distorted, are they not?
To answer that substantively, or would you like to have a go first at the
The content? Yes. If this is about transmission network charges and how those are allocated, that falls within, I guess, the natural monopoly regulation side of the work. And again, that would be appealable to the CMA if someone wanted to take a view on that. And
by CMA to Ofgem in terms of these charges.
So in relation to distribution, there is an appeal currently ongoing, which the CMA is considering. And whenever a decision is made, so the Ofgem makes these decisions on a periodic basis in relation to transmission and distribution, whenever that decision is made, it is appealable to the CMA. So if people have a problem with it, then it can be appealed, and a panel of independent members will consider the issue.
I mean, just in terms of a general response, I mean, we do obviously have regular discussions with Ofgem in relation to consumer concerns that either are brought to the CMA on behalf of consumers in Scotland, or indeed to Ofgem, who also have a key role in terms of addressing consumer issues in Scotland. I mean, my role is primarily here to ensure that people like the energy team that have been answering your questions today are fully apprised of the context in Scotland, the political debate, and the role of consumer bodies in Scotland, to ensure that they have every opportunity to give evidence of the kind that you've been discussing today, and also to ensure that the energy team have appropriate access to policymakers who may be making decisions that are relevant in the Scottish Government.
Thank you.
Just for the avoidance of doubt, the substance of what you're saying around transmission losses leads me to the conclusion that the argument that says reduce transmission charges to favour a power generator such as Longannet is going in the opposite direction to the changes that you would want to make to favour consumers in Scotland and the north of England.
Sorry, so in relation to losses, the interests, as it were, the short-term parochial interests of consumers and generators are opposite.
Yep, that's what I mean.
Okay, if there are no more questions, can I thank you very much on behalf of the committee for coming along. That's been a good, quite lengthy session, and I'm very grateful to you for explaining things as clearly and as simply as you were able to, which is considerable assistance to the non-technical members of the committee. Thank you very much. We will now have a short suspension. Thank you. And go into private session, I should say.